Good morning. Happy Mother's Day to those of you who are proclaimers of that title. We begin this morning with a word from the three of us.
On Tuesday, Reverend Karen Thompson, who is our Associate UCC General Minister, wrote this. Dear siblings, in this moment when abortion rights are under assault, please know this. The United Church of Christ faithfully supported access to safe abortion before Roe v. Wade, and we faithfully support it now. This is not a draft for us. This is discipleship.
As your clergy team, we are committed to the work of justice along with you.
As people of faith, we affirm our belief that it is a right for all people to have equal and easy access to comprehensive health care, including abortion.
We affirm our intention to provide comprehensive sexuality education to all ages and to all who want it.
We affirm that your body is your own, that your life has value, and the choices that you make for your sacred self will be honored.
We stand in solidarity today and every day with those who walk the path of justice, honoring all who have walked before us that we may make an easier path for those who follow.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. It may feel sometimes like you are just one person, just one voice, all alone in a busy and hectic world, but we are here to assure you that you are not. You are not alone. You are surrounded by many. Welcome to worship.
Love and the
to hope, to be hopeful in bad times, is not just foolishly romantic. It is based on the fact that human history is a history not only of cruelty, but also of compassion, sacrifice, courage, and kindness. What we choose to emphasize in this complex history will determine our lives. If we see only the worst, it destroys our capacity to do something. If we remember those times and places, and there are so many, where people have behaved magnificently, this gives us the energy to act, and at least the possibility of sending this spinning top of a world in a different direction. Will you rise in body or in spirit or both and join in this call to worship? Section one is this section right here. Section two will be our center two wedges. And section three over here with Philip at the piano. May these words be the first of many affirming nudges you notice today. Whether the message that resonates most with you is,
keep going. You're amazing.
You're doing okay. Or something else. And may you marvel at how, if you pay attention, affirming nudges often come in truly unexpected places. The random kindness of a stranger. And while you're waiting for the next nudge to come your way, may you support the cycle, serving as the gentle nudger for someone else who, like all of us, is fervently longing to feel affirmed. Amen.
All right. If it is your birthday in May, June, or July, would you raise your hands? Okay. You have a special role in this song. It's called The Welcome Table, and it goes, I'm going to sit at the welcome table. I'm going to sit at the welcome table one of these days. I'm going to sit at the welcome table. Sit at the welcome table one of these days. But there's a hallelujah in there. So when I raise my hand like this, you May, June, and Julyers, give us a good hallelujah. Okay? Hallelujah. Ready? Ellen and I will give you a quick round on it, and then please rise if you are able, and let's join together in the singing. I'm gonna sit at the welcome table. I'm gonna sit at the welcome table one of these days. I'm gonna sit at the welcome table. Sit at the welcome table one of these days. I'm gonna feast on milk and honey. I'm gonna feast on milk and honey one of these days. I'm gonna feast on milk and honey. Feast on milk and honey one of these days. I'm gonna tell God how you treat me. I'm gonna tell God how you treat me one of these days. I'm gonna tell God how you treat me. Tell God how you treat me one of these days. All God's children gonna sit together. All God's children gonna sit together one of these days. All God's children gonna sit together. Sit together all of these days. I need a better hallelujah. Let's do the first skit. I'm gonna sit at the welcome table. I'm gonna sit at, here comes table, one of these days.
Hallelujah!
I'm gonna sit at the welcome table. Sit at the welcome table one of these days. That was good. I'm gonna sit at the welcome table one of these days. Yeehaw! All right, it is the time for the children. So come on down, boys and girls who want to join us for our time with the children this morning. Will you? Okay. Ooh. Okay. Oh, good morning, everyone. How are you all today? It's wonderful to see so many of you. It's wonderful to be with you today. Today, we are going to tell you the story of Miss Twiggly's tree. And this is one of my absolute favorite children's stories in all the wide world. So you can either look at the screen or you can turn around and look at our actors over here. Okay? Sound good? All right, Glenn, be careful on that edge. That always makes me nervous.
I got it.
Okay. All right, my friends, take it away.
Funny Miss Twiggly lived in a tree with a dog named Puss and a color TV. She did what she liked. She liked what she did. But when company came, Miss Twiggly hid.
It's not that I do not like people,
said she.
But one gets a bit shy when one lives in a tree.
Old Miss Twiggly was friendly with bears.
They shed on the sofa,
she said.
But who cares? They don't find me odd, and I'm grateful for that. I don't think they'd mind if I slept on my hat.
And just to be sure, she slept in her hat. Miss Twiggly and Puss were happy up there, high above the ground and a tree in the air. But simply disgraceful, said the people in town, to live in a tree and never come down. The wife of the mayor was maddest of all.
To not be at home when I call is unforgivable. And besides that, I have been told she sleeps in her hat. Miss Spousey must know of a town law N,
said she,
against things of that kind going on in a tree.
She marched to the mayor.
Now what can you do? That house in the tree is spoiling our view. Miss Twiggly's a nuisance no town should allow. A person to hang up her wash on a bough. The smoke from her chimney is causing a smog. And she lives, so they say, with some bears and a dog.
They're dear. I agree. But more pressing problems are bothering me. The weather report says it's going to rain. And I fear we are in for a wild hurricane.
It did rain for a week and a month and a day. The wind blew a gale and the bridge washed away.
The bridge.
The bridge washed away. The bridge. The town was, they were stuck, and there's more.
They wonder.
The town was cut off, its people afloat. Whatever went by, they used for a boat. The road in the meadow was one stormy sea, and right in the middle stood the house in the tree. Old Miss Twiggly had battered her hatches and checked her supply of tea and dry matches.
String up some hammocks, build platforms, find chairs. We may have some callers, and wet ones at that. I'll go change the bows on my best sleeping hat. I'll get right to work on a big pot of stew to be sure there'll be plenty to to feed quite a few.
She put on the kettle and she buttered some bread.
Now let them all come. I'm ready,
she said.
Miss Twigley, Miss Twigley, yoo-hoo! Is there room in your house for a wet friend or two?
There's room for you all. Come up, come inside. Climb up while it's warm. Come up and be dry.
They hauled up the mayor and the chief of police and sweet Trudy Wilmot, the grocery man's niece. There were pigs and a cat and the dogs of the town. Up came the plump Miss Honk, though she was afraid of stairs, and even little Joe Pettibone, who was scared of the bears. And in the last boat, bedraggled and wet, came the wife of the mayor, looking very upset. She felt so ashamed of the words she had said, when her host declared,
I fixed you my bed.
Miss Twigley's new friends were cozy and warm, sheltered and fed and out of the storm. Though the wind made the rain go splittery splat, the mayor's wife slept soundly in Miss Twigley's hat. They pretended the house was a Noah's Ark. They played games and sang till long after dark. Now the town folks were glad, just as pleased as could be, that funny Miss Twigley lived in a tree. And Miss Twigley found out something wonderful too. When emergencies come, don't think about you. You help all you can, and you never ask why.
The first thing you know,
you forget to be shy.
You help all you can, and you don't ask why, and the first thing you know, you forget to be shy. I love this story. We must have read this story 100 times a year because I loved it so much for each of my kids. I love it because it tells a great story. You know, a number of years ago, when a hurricane was coming to Florida, we had friends come to our house. We had friends come from Tampa, and we also had friends come from St. Augustine. They came from both coasts, both sides of the state, and we all gathered together in our house. Was it crowded? Yes, it was. But it was delightful to be together, to be safe, and to know that we had each other to rely on. And our hope is that you all know that too, with your friends here in the church, with your families, and with God. So thank you all for being a wonderful audience this morning. And let's say a quick prayer. Oh God, we give thanks for those opportunities and those times when we come together and we forget to be shy, when we know that when there's need in the world, we respond with open hearts and open hands, and we know we belong. Amen. All right, my friends, is it anyone's birthday today or this week? No birthdays? Any birthdays? Any birthdays over here today or this week? Yeah? Judy, you want to stand up and tell us your name?
Yeah.
Judy? Anyone else? Oh, Judy, it's all you. Let's sing.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Judy. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, and boys and girls, you may now depart for your activity, for your United Tribes. Thank you for being great audiences.
There are many prayers on the hearts and minds of our church family this week. First, we pray for all who do the sacred work of mothering in the world, for those who create and sustain life. We give you our gratitude and our deep love. Eid Mubarak for all of those who celebrated the end of the holy month of Ramadan this week. We celebrate with our Muslim brothers and sisters and siblings. We pray for Candace King as she travels to Texas to advocate for her niece, that there will be a positive outcome in a custody battle. We are praying for Wallace, who is the father of Don Smith Lopez. Wallace is transitioning to hospice for comfort care, and we pray that the transition be peaceful. For Cindy Martin, who is recovering well from hand surgery last Thursday. For baby Gaia, who will have surgery this Tuesday. For her mother, Nevada, and Auntie Shauna. For Isabel, who is suffering back pain after a recent injury. For Terry Hamilton, who was recently diagnosed with cancer. For his wife, Annette, and son, Tyler. Terry is a close friend of Lisa and Steve Goldstein. We pray for Michael, who is a fifth grader recovering from a serious stroke. Michael is a classmate of some of our UCG children. We are praying for Family Promise as they transition back into rotational housing, continuing their mission to provide hospitality for those experiencing homelessness. And we are praying for all of our neighbors, especially those this week who are graduating from the University of Florida. And finally, this week in the wake of the leaked document from the Supreme Court, we have heard from many of you who have expressed rage and fear, disillusionment, exhaustion, those who have already done so much of this work and those not sure where to go from here. Please hear again our commitment to you and to justice. In these unprecedented days, even the most seasoned advocates and organizers among us are a bit at a loss. There are so many courses of action, and should you need a safe place to tell your story, to rant a little bit, to brainstorm ideas of where to give and how to act, we are here for you. Be in touch. We love you all, sacred, wonderful people. We are not alone. No one is. Amen. Let us take a moment in sacred silence and lift up all that we are carrying. Mother of us all, give us a glimpse of your hopes for us. You, in perpetual labor, constantly pushing, seeking to bear new life among us, despite us. You carry us in your depths. You nurture us by your own body of creation. You groan through the pain of birthing new possibilities without promise of what they will become. Help us to see the potential that keeps you pushing day after day. What keeps you so hopeful about us that you choose not to stop, even when we deny where we came from. the capabilities we possess? Do you pray for us as you push? One day, maybe today, it could be today, make it be today, that they will live into these possibilities for life to thrive. Thanks be, Mothering One, for your strength, your hope, your everlasting love. Amen.
By the fire for everyone.
Isn't that a great song? Yeah. Whew. Good job, ladies. Today's scripture is a story that actually is repeated a number of different places in the Gospels, but I found what I think is the most gentle one. This is from Luke. This is a story that Jesus tells. A man once gave a great dinner party and invited a large number to it. And when the dinner hour came, he sent around his servant to say to those who were invited, "Come, for it is ready." And they all immediately began to excuse themselves. The first one said to him, "I have bought a piece of land and I must go and look at it. Please have me excused." Another said, "I have just been married, so I cannot come." So the servant went back and reported this to his master. Then the master of the house was angry and said to his servant, "Hurry out into the streets and the squares of the city and bring in the poor, the maimed, the blind, and the lame. Bring them all in here." And the servant said, "What you ordered, sir, has been done, and there is still room." And the master said to the servant, "Go out onto the roads and among the hedges and make them come in, so that my house may be full. For I tell you that none of those who were invited shall taste my dinner." I missed Easter this year. Well, that's not exactly true. I didn't miss it. I mean, I was still alive, and the day still came. But it was the first time in as long as I can remember that I wasn't in the church, not including that COVID year. I was home, tuning in from my back porch to our YouTube feed in my pajamas with a cup of coffee and with COVID. It wasn't awful, the physical part at least. Mostly a bad cold with a few days of fever and a dull, annoying headache. The separation was probably the most challenging part, not just from you all, but that was tough, but also from our girls, too, who somehow, miraculously, didn't get it. And to be honest, it was mostly just inconvenient. Now, I don't mean to be flippant. I know that in the next few days, the United States will surpass 1 million deaths from COVID-19. I am one of the fortunate 82 million people who have gotten it and survived. And for me, triple vaxxed and pretty cautious, it was mostly inconvenient. And I missed you, and I missed Easter. I missed the pomp, the celebration, the trumpets, the hallelujah chorus, all that good stuff, all the people flowing through. I missed all that. But you know what I might have missed almost as much as all of that? The after party. We've had a long tradition of gathering with chosen family and having an epic Easter feast. We cook for days. We drink the good wine. We set a long table and we feast like there's no tomorrow. And then we linger. When we've had our fill, we push away from the table and we reconvene in the living room for the mandatory talent show. This might be an introvert's worst nightmare, but for me, it is a delight. There's lots of laughter, there's a lot of cheers, sometimes even tears. There was even a marriage proposal one year, although technically the couple was already engaged, but they asked me to marry them. I said yes, woo! And when we've all had our fill of all of that, then we dance. Sometimes into the wee hours of the morning. Mercy me. Hallelujah. It is delightful. And to me, There is no better way to affirm Jesus' most profound acts of charity, of love, and mercy than to have an epic party. In fact, I think that's the whole point of Easter. And if I had my way, we would swap out all of the crucifixes in the world and trade them for dinner plates, which I think is a more appropriate symbol for what Jesus tried to teach us. There is too much cruelty in this world already. Too much cruelty these days. There are too many people with too much power inflicting too much harm on too many of us. There's too much tragedy occurring in the world right now, in a world that can't afford it. Can't afford the damages inflicted by war. Can't afford the damages of climate change or pandemic-related poverty. Can't afford the cruelty that seems to be taking place. There are too many times and too many of us who are left holding our heads in confusion and asking, how has it come to this? How has it come to this? Mercy, Lord, have mercy. What we need is a little more mercy. We need more people to act to relieve the suffering of others for no other reason than the purpose of pure compassion. We need to be more compassionate with ourselves for the fears that we're not willing to take on at this time, for the places where we think we might be falling a little short. We need a little mercy to remind us how beautiful this life is, how beautiful this life can be. Fortunately, history has a way of repeating itself. We are not the first to wonder if the world is crashing down around us. There are apocalyptic cults in every generation, but there is a little comfort in knowing that others have faced hardship before and somehow found some way to remain resilient. So if we can return to that Easter story again, one more time, you might recall how that is precisely how the disciples felt, hiding away, holding their heads in worry, wondering how it ever came to be like this, just after Jesus had been taken away and slaughtered. But do you remember where that risen Jesus first appears to all the disciples? Not just some of them, all of them. Not just Mary and Peter and the people in the garden. Do you remember where Jesus first appears to all of the disciples? Say it again. It was in the same room where they had been together on the Thursday the week before, the site of the Last Supper. And there's something important in that. It is a biblical bookend. Whenever there's a biblical bookend like that, that means the tellers of the story are giving us a very obvious clue that this is something important. In fact, it might be the most important piece of the whole story. Here's how that narrative plays out. It's Thursday night. Jesus is with his followers. They're having a wonderful dinner party. More specifically, they're having the Passover feast, which is the most joy-filled and the most important feast of the year. The Passover is the celebration of the Jewish people's freedom from their enslavement in Egypt. It's a joyous occasion. When the faithful gather together, they remember that they are God's people and that they are a people who have been liberated from a hostile oppressor. Hallelujah. It's a party. And it was at that party that we know, which we know is Maundy Thursday, which sounds so moody, it sounds so melancholy, but that actually comes from the French word mandantum, which means commandment. It is at that party where Jesus imparts his most basic and perhaps most important message. Eat this bread. Drink this cup. Remember me. Love them as I have loved you. This is what the kingdom of heaven is like for you and for me. Unfortunately, the party gets broken up a little too soon, just after this commandment is issued. After Jesus was arrested and all the terribleness ensued, the trials, the tribunals, the death, the tomb, but then the resurrection, the early morning and the first day in the garden.
Hallelujah.
But then the first regathering of the disciples of Jesus and the followers takes place where? Back at that same place. Back at that same table where they had just celebrated Passover. Only now there's a new covenant, a new commandment. Eat, drink, remember, and love them as I have loved you. Lord, have mercy. It was theologian Diana Butler Bass who pointed this out. Thank you, Gary Kirkland, for sending that amazing article. She goes on to remind us that Jesus, in his resurrected state, never returns to the cross. He doesn't parade the disciples up to the hill. He doesn't point to the blood-soaked soil and say, "See what you made me do? See what I did for you?" He never mentions it again. But you know what he does mention? The table. Time and time again, in place after place, God is revealed to the people through the breaking of the bread and the communal table. It happens in Emmaus. It happens in Jerusalem. It happens in Galilee. Maybe that's the point of the whole story. Perhaps we should trade in our crucifixes for dinner plates. The best parties that I have ever been to are the ones where the bread is no bread at all, but is actually the bread of life, my life, your life, all broken open for each other. And the wine is not wine at all, but is actually this communal life blood, this most sacred liquid imaginable. It is my blood, your blood, our communal blood poured out together. Shared together, passed from hand to hand, from heart to heart, around a gathered table with a communal cup which is filled and then emptied and then filled again. Some of the most sacred experiences of my life have taken place when there was a shared meal. How many of you are with me?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. When I used to lead our youth groups on work tours, if the homeowners that we were helping ever gifted us with a meal, I would stop all the work and have everyone gather around and participate. And oh, the meals. Am I right, brother? Oh, the meals, the jambalaya, the bean burritos. One time in New Orleans, a woman showed up with a bag full of boiled crawfish. One time in Ocean Springs, we were working with a cul-de-sac of families, and they hosted us all together in the cul-de-sac, and they had potato salad, and they had fried chicken, and they had greens, and oh, Scott has given me the hallelujah in the back. It was amazing, amazing, and we were all together sharing the same cup, sitting around, smiling, celebrating that great commandment to love one another as we have been loved, even when we don't deserve it. I once read that Jesus was a pretty good storyteller, but a great party planner. He'd throw the wildest parties around, the kind that broke all the rules of etiquette by inviting the priests and the prostitutes, the politicians and the zealots, the government representatives, the sinners, the saints, all the people together sharing the same cup, breaking the same bread, singing the same songs, participating in what the true kingdom is all about. Light, love, laughter, and mercy. Mercy. Whew. Mercy. The mercy of the most audacious kind that welcomes you to a spot at the table and showers you with compassion and really means it when it says that no matter who you are or where you are on your life's journey, you are welcome here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What if it is as simple as that? The table, the stew pot, the shelter from the storm, or the places where we are most likely to find the love and the grace and the mercy that we are searching for. The comfort that we long for, that we're supposed to feel, and the love that we're supposed to offer to everyone else. The place where we find hope in the bad times, the compassion, the sacrifice, the courage, and the kindness to see us through. Remember those places? Remember those places. That's why Miss Twigley's Tree is one of my favorite stories. It's not just a story about an odd social outcast who becomes a hero rescuing her town. Nor is it just a redemption tale about those who would be so cruel and judgmental one day to have a turn of heart in times of trouble the next. Though I do love that part of the story. It is a story about undeserved love and unrequited grace, and most of all, it's a story about mercy. Mercy shared and mercy given over a pot of stew with an eccentric crew high up in a tree. If we're lucky in life, we might know love. If we're really lucky, we might get a glimpse of grace every now and again. But mercy, that's the winning ticket. That's the prize of prizes. That's the rarest of gems. Mercy, a universal absolution from the fears that we've been holding on to, the fears that we've been hiding from, and then the compassion to ease our burdens and the charge to ease the burdens of others.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Please join me in prayer. Lord, have mercy. We come into this world alone. And we go out of this world alone. But in between, it's you and me. When the world feels fear-filled, when the harshness of the world can't be hushed, when our spirits run low and our hearts feel so heavy, breathe your spirit upon us, O God. Kindle aflame our hearts. Light our eyes with your love for our world, and let your beacon shine through us, filling us with lightness and with grace, so that we might all know and we might all show a little mercy now. Amen. Let's sing.
Thank you.
a great day to come to UCG. Our confirmation class will be meeting with representatives from our boards and committees just after this service over in the West Wing. The youth group's second Sunday evening meeting scheduled for this evening has been canceled. Turns out it's Mother's Day. So please take the time to celebrate the caregivers in your life, and please RSVP for next week's camping trip. Thanks, you all, for coming here. Also, there's a fantastic seminar today offered by Eric Nelson, talking about an amazing way that they are supporting mothers through mobile health care in Haiti. So please join us over in Reimer Hall. If you're a visitor today, we got a million UCGers who are here who can't wait to welcome you. And to the rest of you, so good to see you. Thank you for coming out this morning. But now receive this benediction. May God go with you. May God walk where you walk, guide where you must make choices, comfort where you hurt, and surprise you by God's continued love for you and what you are and what you do. Now that the worship has ended, let the service begin. Go in peace.